Our responsive scripture reading is taken from the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 1 to 3 and verses 15 and 16. I will start reading the first verse and you will respond by reading the next verse and so on till we reach the last verse together. Reading from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called.
With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love.
Eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace.
Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ.
Together, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. The Lord's messenger today is Mr. Leow Wen Pin from BGSD, speaking on inclusion, growing up in Christ.
Hi, good morning everyone, both here and online. It's my great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker for today. You can read his bio in the bulletin, both the PDF forms as well as the online link that many of you would have received. Wen Pin, I'm proud to call my friend and colleague at Biblical Graduate School of Theology. Let me just give you the official bio first. Wen Pin is the president of Koinonia Inclusion Network, a parachurch organization that promotes inclusion of persons with special needs in churches. So he's eminently qualified to speak to us on this topic this morning. He's also director for the Center of Disability Ministry in Asia, and he lectures in biblical and interdisciplinary studies at BGSD. He's also serving as a lay pastor at Singapore Life Church. He tells me that well, one of the things that is little known about him is that he used to worship at Zion Serangoon, our mother church, our sister church now, for a few years before he moved on to other churches. So we are glad to at least claim him as one of our own at one point in our personal histories. Let me now tell him something about him that you may not know. Wen Pin was with the Ministry of Education as a teacher for many years, and he's brought some of those gifts and learning into the seminary that we are part of. And by all accounts, he's done a brilliant job. He's been teaching languages, Hebrew and Greek sometime in the past, as well as Old Testament topics with us. So I'm glad to welcome, on behalf of Zion Bishan, my friend, my colleague, Wen Pin, up to speak to us from God. Wen Pin, let me ask you to come up and you can take off, of course, your mask when you speak to us. And let me pray for you as we listen to God through you. Let's pray together. Lord, we ask for you to speak to us this morning through your servant, Brother Wen Pin. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, greetings, my brothers and sisters in Christ. I am absolutely delighted to be here. Thank you, Z, for that very kind introduction. What Z didn't mention, of course, is that he was my New Testament lecturer, and it was also under his guidance that I went into full-time ministry. So thank you, brother, for that. As you can tell, I have many dear friends who worship here, and so I am very, very pleased with this opportunity to share God's word with the community at Zion Bishan, which has blessed me in so many ways throughout the years. My warm thanks especially to the pastors for the invitation to speak in your Get Real series about the important topic of the inclusion of people with disabilities in the church community. So let's prepare ourselves in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, as Psalm 133 reminds us, how good and pleasant it is when the people of God dwell together in unity. Indeed, Lord, as we come to your holy word to understand the gospel, to understand how you call us to be an inclusive people, we ask that you open our hearts, renew our minds, and move us to love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, sometimes people ask me how I got involved in disability work. And that happened because when I first became a Christian in university, it seemed obvious to me from the Bible that Christians should actively serve the marginalized in society. After all, Jesus said, "As you do to the least of these, you do to me." And so when I returned from my studies, I started volunteering. And about 10 years ago, I joined AWA, a social service agency, as a volunteer. And at AWA, I served children on the more severe end of the disability spectrum. And at that time, the reason why I served was to bless people with disabilities. I wanted to give something to them. However, after I interacted more and more with people with disabilities, I started to see them less as a group of needy people and more as just people, as individuals. I realized that each one of them was a person with their own hopes and dreams, strengths and weaknesses, and their own personalities. I made friends with them, got to know their hearts, and ultimately received blessings from them and kindness from them. It was then that I realized that I had volunteered with a rather paternalistic mindset. I had served to give something to them, but slowly I realized that they gave far more to me through their friendship, their optimism, and their spirit. I realized something that many people serving in the disability sector already know. People with disabilities always give you back more than you can give. When I realized this, I changed the way I volunteered. I no longer saw myself as an outsider coming in to bless the disability community, but rather I saw myself as part of that community, both giving and receiving. It helped me realize that persons with disabilities had the passion to serve as well, even as I also desired to serve them. Now, I share with you this personal story of mine to remind us of something very important. This story tells us that our vision of community shapes how we build that community. Our vision of community shapes how we build that community. And so when I had a paternalistic mindset, I served in a top-down fashion to people with disabilities. But when I changed my mindset, when I changed my vision of community, I started to serve alongside people with disabilities, eager to receive, even as I was eager to give. Because our vision of community shapes how we build that community. And so, my friends, my task today is to help us gain a renewed vision of the church and thus to reshape how we build the church. And the verse that I will focus on today is Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, which we read just now. Ephesians 4, 16 develops the magnificent portrait of the church that Paul has outlined in the first three chapters of the letter. Previously, Paul told us that the church is Jesus' body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. He also told us that we are members of the same body and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. And so, my friends, we are not merely a group of people. We are the body of Christ. That is Paul's vision for the church. And so it is this vision, being the body of Christ, that must shape how we build a church. And this is exactly what Paul teaches us in our text for today in Ephesians 4:16. In 4:16, Paul says, the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. In this verse, based on Paul's vision of the church being the body of Christ, Paul gives us three insights about how we should build up the church community, three ways in which we should live as a community. The first thing that the passage says is that the whole body is joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped. And so Paul's vision for the church is not one where the body is a separate, disconnected collection of parts, like a mannequin that has yet to be put together. Rather, the body of Christ is joined together, held together, bonded together. And the way that this bond is maintained, according to Paul, is through every joint with which it is equipped. Note that it is not a few joints, it's not some joints, it's every joint. Every joint is essential in holding the body together. Now, this is the first important insight that I'd like to draw your attention to. Every joint is required. Everyone has an essential role in building up the church. The growth of the church requires every Christian. Now, this has two profound implications with regard to the inclusion of people with disabilities in the church. First, if every joint is required, this means that our brothers and sisters with disabilities are not an optional add-on, whom the church includes when we feel like it, but rather every joint is required. It means that the grand project of building the church cannot be done without these fellow brothers and sisters. It would be like an arm without a wrist, an elbow, or a shoulder. The inclusion of people with disabilities is not something a church does only when it's mature enough or developed enough, but rather God desires for His church to be built by including every believer, including those with disabilities. Every joint is required. My second point is especially for those of us who have disabilities who are here today. My second point is this. Brothers and sisters, God wants you here. God wants you here. Society may have made you feel insecure because of your disability. Society may have made you feel unwelcome. And so you may be tempted to exclude yourself, to take yourself out of fellowship, to think that you are not wanted here. But no, God wants you here. Because without you, the body is not joined together, and the body will fall apart. Now, even as I'm saying this, I suspect that we may be asking, why? Why are our brothers and sisters with disabilities essential to building the church? Well, there are actually many reasons we can find for this in the Bible, but let me just focus on one today. Like many theologians before me, I believe that people with disabilities have a prophetic role in the church, a prophetic role. I'm not talking about forecasting the future. I'm thinking about the Old Testament prophets who challenged the people of God to rethink their attitudes, their ways, and their practices. For example, are we tempted sometimes to over-intellectualize the faith? If so, then people with disabilities, intellectual disabilities in our midst, ask us, how about me? Or are we caught up in the worship wars over what kind of songs and instruments we should play in church? Then our deaf friends ask us, how about me? Or maybe we are overemphasizing programs over relationships. And then those who can't even come for our programs ask us, how about me? Because, it's because of their disabilities, our brothers and sisters force us to ask the question, what exactly is church? What is at the heart of church? If a person cannot speak or hear, if reasoning or interacting is difficult, then what exactly is church about? And so these brothers and sisters, simply by being with us, they push us towards the heart of the faith, what is central to the faith. This was brought home to me in an interview that we did with a brother in Christ called Jeremiah. Jeremiah told us about his relationship with his late brother Ezekiel, who had profound cerebral palsy. And because of his cerebral palsy, Ezekiel was largely immobile. Yet, because of this disability, Jeremiah told us this, and I quote, "We knew that Ezekiel was a gift from God. He brought my family together, and I believe caring for my brother helped me to grow to become a more compassionate person. I would not trade him for anything. I would not make that trade because of how central he was to us, because of how he blessed us. For Ezekiel reminded us of what family was all about and what life was really all about. It is not the daily hustle and bustle. It is not about striving for achievements. Rather, Ezekiel taught us that the most important things in life are almost always the simple things, such as a loving family." End quote. And so, my friends, every joint is required. And persons with disabilities are not an optional add-on. They are not merely a good to have. Rather, having them as precious members of our community is how the body of Christ is designed to work. In the body of Christ, every joint is required. So the first point we have seen today is that every joint is required for the body of Christ to be built up. So let's consider now a second point. Ephesians 4:16 continues to say that the body is built up when each part is working properly. So let's hear that again. When each part is working properly. So now we see the idea of each and every being repeated again. Previously it was every joint, now it is each part. So what we said just now about each and every believer being absolutely necessary for building up the church, that is further confirmed in this part of the verse. Yet at the same time, a new idea is being introduced. And the new idea is that each part has to work. And not just work, but to work properly, doing their fair share and pulling their weight. This immediately challenges our view of persons with disabilities. For too long, churches have viewed people with disabilities as simply passive recipients of care, of charity. But if we take this verse seriously, it tells us that God expects all of us to work in building up the church, including people with disabilities. And therefore, churches should not view them as recipients of charity. Rather, we should view them as co-equal disciples of Christ, and even more, co-equal disciple makers in Christ. You see, being disabled is not the same as being unable. Being disabled does not mean you are unable. In fact, earlier in Ephesians 4 verse 7 tells us that grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. In other words, every believer is given gifts by Christ to build up the church, whether you have disabilities or not. And so, for example, I'm very happy to report to you that just yesterday, during KIN's annual general meeting, we elected a new management committee member called Alistair. Alistair now heads our volunteer engagement efforts. And like Ezekiel, whom I spoke about earlier, Alistair also has cerebral palsy, and he is a wheelchair user. But do you know that Alistair is also a missions leader in his church? That he has participated in over 40 mission trips, and that he has even led a missions trip with a team of 30 members overseas. And because Alistair has mobility issues, he has difficulty lifting his arms, during his overseas trips, he needs to ask his team members to help him change his clothes, to shower, and to even use the toilet. Now, I think we can ask ourselves, will we go for a missions trip if we knew we had to ask our team members to shower us? Well, that's what my brother Alistair has done. And you can imagine what kind of an example of dedication he sets for his team by putting aside his pride to serve Jesus. And so every part of the body can work, must work, to build up the church. Now, if we recognize this, then the task for us is to figure out what gift of God that Christ has given a brother or sister with disabilities and to help them fan it into flame. But the obstacle we will face is this. We are usually too quick to see a person's disabilities rather than their gifts. Some time ago, I had a gout attack in my foot, and I could not walk properly. And during that time, whenever I met people, all they would ever talk to me about was my foot. It was as though my whole body, my whole person, had been reduced to my gout. But likewise, when we meet a person with, say, autism, is their autism all that we focus on? Well, I suspect that is what we will naturally do, because our attention is drawn to what is different. But that must not be our culture as churches. Rather, our culture must be to invest time to get to know each person with a disability as a whole person, as an individual, as a person gifted by Christ with gifts to build up the church. Now, sometimes people ask me, you know, you need to have all these special skills to minister. And the answer is no, this does not take special skills. But it does take patience and love. Recently, I was reading a story to my sons, and the story went like this. Once upon a time, there was a family of 4 crayons, red, blue, green, and white. And one day, the family of crayons was used to color a beautiful picture of a sunny day. The red crayon was used to color the red flowers, the blue crayon, blue skies, and the green crayon, green grass meadows. But there was nothing for the white crayon to color. And so the white crayon grew sad, felt out of place, and started to cry. And when the other crayons saw this, they felt sad too, because they loved the white crayon. And so they went to the white crayon and said, "Oh, please don't cry." But the white crayon said, "Why shouldn't I cry? I'm useless." But then the 3 crayons replied, saying, you are not useless. Look, your white can be put on the green grass to highlight the dew, on the red flowers to color the young buds, and in the sky to paint the clouds. We need you to make the picture beautiful. Likewise, brothers and sisters, we need to be like the three crayons. We need to focus on the potential in our fellow brothers and sisters with disabilities and not focus on their disabilities. We need to spend time to see the work of God that God is doing in their lives. And do you know what? As the church does this, we learn to do it for everyone, not just those with disabilities. After all, isn't this what you hope that people do for you? To not judge a book by its cover, to see past our mistakes, to see past our masks, to see the work of God in each one of us. That is what being a true community is about, isn't it? When we do that for each other, we enable each part of the body of Christ to work properly as God intended. So thus far, we have heard 2 points. Every joint is required, and each part must work properly. So people with disabilities must therefore be included in our communities, and they must be included in discipleship and disciple making. Let's come to our third point. Ephesians 4:16 concludes with these words: makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. And the point that this part of the verse is making is simply this: the body grows in love. The fertilizer for church growth is love. And the kind of love that we see in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the kind of love that looks upon human brokenness and weeps, but then crosses over and then sacrifices itself for the other. The kind of love that rises again, giving hope of restoration for all humanity. You see, what really addresses disability, what really addresses all forms of brokenness, is the love of Jesus. After all, there are so many people in the world who do not have a disability, but they are still profoundly broken. Shattered families, trauma, addiction, alienation, and so on. What all of us need are healing communities, but not necessarily healing our physical wounds or our disabilities, but communities that heal broken hearts through the love of Christ. As the eminent disability theologian John Swinton observes, God may choose to cure people, but that is not the church's primary responsibility. The primary gift that the church has to offer is the creation of a graceful space for meeting, within where the possibility of listening, understanding, friendship, belonging, and tenderness becomes real. The church is not called to become a community of psychiatrists. It is called to become a community of persistent, patient love. Now, this is why when we engage with a church and they ask us, should we set up a disability ministry in our church? Our answer is, maybe. And our answer is, maybe, because what we are really looking for is not a ministry or a program. Rather, we look for rich networks of relationships where brother loves brother, sister loves sister, because that is where inclusion truly takes place. Disability ministries are a stepping stone towards that. but it is authentic communities that are the real goal. Love is the real goal. For love never fails. And love transforms churches into what God desires us to be. So this is why I'm a fan of the Japanese art of kintsugi. In kintsugi, broken vessels are joined together with lacquer mixed with powdered gold. In this form of art, the artisan does not shy away from the brokenness of the vessel, but rather highlights the brokenness with gold to turn the vessel into something even more beautiful than it was before. Indeed, for the church, our gold is our love. Our love is what turns human brokenness, human disability, into something more profound, into something more beautiful, into something which glorifies God. Let me illustrate this by sharing with you one last story. And since Zion Bishan has an interpretation ministry, let me share with you a story about a deaf friend of mine called Isabel. Isabel is a talented photographer. That's a photo of us together in my slightly slimmer days. And when Isabel was younger, she joined the youth ministry of Wesley Methodist Church. So how did they love Isabel in youth ministry? Well, during cell group time, her cell group members saw that the leader was taking notes for Isabel. After all, she couldn't hear. So what the youth members did is they started to volunteer to take notes for Isabel. After that, the youth asked Isabel to teach them how to sign the alphabet, and then after that, to sign worship songs so that she could be better included in cell group. And then after that, some of them even registered with Wesley's Ministry of the Hearing Impaired to learn sign language to communicate better with her. And in fact, some of them have now even stepped up as sign language interpreters for the church. You see, their love for Isabel, their loving response towards her and her disability grew the ministry, grew the church into something more amazing. And so, my brothers and sisters, will you likewise respond to the words of Ephesians 4:16. Knowing that each joint is required, will you actively invite persons with disabilities into this community, knowing that God wants them here? Knowing that each part must work properly, will you go beyond merely allowing people with disabilities to be present and move towards discipling them into disciple makers and missionaries? And knowing that the body builds itself up in love, will you share God's love with them and let them share God's love with you? Because we know that together we make the body of Christ ever more beautiful. Well, it is now my pleasure to invite Deaconess Sherina Low, who heads up the Enabling Ministry at Zion, and who is also an advisory council member to KIN, to close this sermon by sharing some of her thoughts and then closing us in prayer. Sherina, please.
It was very noisy. Our church fellowship hall was filled with noise of chatterings and laughing. I was feeling lonely. I was feeling unnoticed. The loneliness was real, and the loneliness was painful. In my loneliness, I spotted an elderly person. She was waiting for her transport all by herself. I turned and noticed a tired mother. She was trying to calm her child in a meltdown. Then I saw a helpless-looking young man. He was being spoon-fed by his helper. Physically, they were all part of our church, yet emotionally, they were not part of our church. They too were lonely and unnoticed. I felt overlooked and overwhelmed. I began to have a feeling, a burden for the brokenhearted. I cried out inside me, who and where can these lonely people turn to? Instantly, I felt Jesus was seated next to me and connected with my burdened heart. In this brief but intense moment, I felt only Jesus knew my heart, and only Jesus heard my cries. Soon, I was called to serve as a deaconess in our church. I had the opportunity to show hospitality and connect with the vulnerable. God had prepared me in the most mysterious way. 2 Sundays ago, Pastor Dave challenged us, is it true that those who belong to Jesus really belong to each other? Who are the minority group in our church? They are the differently abled. They are the vulnerable, and they are the marginalized. Do you know of anyone among us who are physically challenged? Do you know of anyone who has cognitive difficulties? And do you know anyone who behave and interact differently? They are the ones who are struggling. They struggle physically, they struggle emotionally, and they struggle socially. A mother who has a special needs son was distressed and frustrated. She often received strange looks because of her son's meltdown. She had been looking for a church where her family would feel welcome. If this group of friends face discrimination outside church, can they find refuge inside church? Can we embrace their differences? Can we be truly inclusive? Or have they been excluded because of our fears, discomforts, and ignorance? Thank you, Pastor Wen Pin, for pointing to us that inclusion is part of discipleship and disciple making. We need Jesus to open our hearts and minds, to reach out to those who are marginalized. Enabling ministry will equip all of you. We will have talks, workshops, resource information. You will be prepared to journey alongside those who need your involvement. We also want to embrace the differently abled, because God gives special talents to you, and it can be a resource. So come, be part of enabling ministry. You will be equipped to be involved. And you who are struggling, connect with us. You are not alone. And you, who have special talents and experiences, you are our resource. God will use you to inspire others. Come, speak with me. Be empowered. You can be empowered. And you will be empowered. Be part of enabling ministry. Shall we pray? Dear God, we thank you for you are a father to the fatherless and a shield to the defenseless. Help us to open our hearts and minds to those who are marginalized. Help Zion Bishan to be your light and your sanctuary. Help us to comfort others with the comfort you have given us. Amen.
I think it's apt for us to also come together as we entrust our Deaconess Sharina into God's hands. Shall we join our hearts together for those of you who are at home also? God, we thank you for this shining example of what faith in Jesus Christ is, dear sister of ours, Sharina, who is not just sitting before your people, but she's testifying of your goodness, of your glory before you and your heavenly host. Pray, Father, that as you have placed much burden on her shoulder, beyond the enabling ministry in Zion Bishan, and also your calling for her in the Muscular Dystrophy Association, that, Father, you will provide for her in every way, whether financially, physically, emotionally, and above all, Lord, provide for her spiritually, so that out of the depths of your presence in her life, Lord, it will overflow to the blessing of the people around her. Thus, we commit Sharina, Lord, into your loving hands. Once again, as you have called her, provide for her that you may use her. In Jesus' name.